And this morning, the commencement speaker is Mr. Bill Jolly, three-time Emmy Award-winning composer, arranger, musical director, and keyboardist. He's been featured twice in Keyboard Magazine and has composed music for HBO, MTV, NBC, ABC, CBS, Showtime, Columbia TriStar Pictures, Coca-Cola, McDonald's, and numerous media outlets. Bill has appeared in commercials and endorsements and has performed before four United States presidents. It's with great enthusiasm that I introduce Bill Jolly as commencement speaker for Westchester University's winter commencement. Bill?
Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. You read it exactly as I wrote it. Let's give the graduating class of 2013 a big hand. Come on. Now, unfortunately, I have a 12:15 train that I got to catch today, okay? So I have to get back to New York because I have two shows to do in New York today. And I really feel bad about that because I wanted to hang out with all of you afterwards. But since I can't hang out with you, I want you to hang out with me. So here's what I'm going to do. Can I take a picture of you real quick? Hold on. Everybody smile. Okay, now over here, everybody smile. Here we go. All right, now all the parents in the back, you smile. There we go. All right, now we're going to be together. Here we go. So, class of 2013, are you ready to graduate? No. I'm going to say that again. Are you ready to graduate? Good. Yeah, I know what you're ready to do, but I hope you've all picked out your designated drivers for the night. I can remember sitting in the same seats that you're sitting in, you know, right now. And I remember thinking to myself, man, I hope this commencement speaker is not long and boring. So what I'm here to tell you is you're in good luck today. So, because, you know, I believe that a good graduation speech is like a good mini dress. It needs to be inspiring, short enough to keep your attention, and long enough to cover the subject matter. So I'm going to be brief. But I want to talk about three things that you probably want to know about. Number one, what are some of the things that helped me to get where I am right now? Number two, will your years here at Westchester really help you in real life? Number three, what the heck are you going to do now? First of all, when I was younger and I was growing up, I was a complete nerd. And all my fellow nerds, raise your hand. Have you got any nerds in here that we... Okay, good. Now, I want all of you popular people to pay attention to who the nerds are, because you're probably going to be asking them for a job in about 3 years. So I started a little band in junior high school, which I named Albatross, which I thought was like for a big, beautiful bird, but I later discovered that it was describing a person who was carrying a heavy emotional burden around his neck. And actually, that was kind of a fitting description, because we had a really great piano player in our band. He was really good. And he was really a better musician than all of us. And so what he decided to do was quit and tell us that we were going to never make it. So anyway, one day I got frustrated and I locked myself in a room and said, I'm going to teach myself how to play the piano. And that's how I started playing the piano. And it seemed like every other day somebody was just quitting on me, you know. It was either my sound man, my lawyer, my guitar player, video editor, recording studio, the publicist, even my girlfriend quit me. And each time, I locked myself in a room and taught myself what they did. Well, not quite with the girlfriend, but you know what I'm saying. Next thing you know, I was a pretty smart guy about a lot of stuff in the business that I initially knew nothing about. I kind of became this independent, one-stop musical guy by total default. I became the pianist for the All-City Jazz Band, and I was building my momentum in my own band, and most importantly, I was losing my nerdiness. I was getting my swag, and I was feeling pretty confident. I would definitely be the man when I got to Westchester. That's what I was feeling. Well, Westchester was pretty good at letting me know right away that I indeed was not going to be the man. You all might not believe this, but the only class I ever flunked in my entire lifetime was Piano 101 here at Westchester. And I tried out for the jazz band for 4 consecutive years and was rejected 4 consecutive years. But you know what? Every single thing that happened to me, from my nerdiness to the people who quit on me to the auditions I failed, was absolutely necessary and probably was the best thing that could have ever happened to me, because I had to make a choice. I was either going to believe what others thought of me and quit, or I was going to work my tail off, really study my craft, and create some respect for the person I believed that I could be. And well, let's talk about the actual degree itself. Well, it's been well documented that Mark Zuckerberg, Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Snapchats, even Spiegel, Oprah, and Mark Cuban, to name a few, were all college dropouts. And Richard Branson, Simon Cowell, even Bill Cosby were high school dropouts. Heck, even Kelly Osbourne, Charlie Sheen, and Lindsay Lohan were high school dropouts. But actually, I can kind of believe that one. But you know what I'm saying. Because of your degree, some of you will actually go right into a job. Because that's what your employer wants. He wants a person who knows X, who has X degree. But according to the U.S. Census Bureau, approximately 3 or 4 of you will actually not end up in the job in the field that you studied here. Think about that for a minute, and I'll give you a minute to look 3 down to figure out which one of you is going to be. Okay. After college, I was a dishwasher, a day camp counselor, and a Keebler cookie salesman. That's Keebler, not Nabisco. We had a thing against Nabisco. We didn't like them. Before I decided to ditch it all and start my own business. So what does that really say? Okay, it says that success is not just about being book smart. It's about being street smart, and sometimes it's just about having plain, good old common sense. But all that leads me to my final bits of advice for you. What does it really take to make it in life and be successful in this world after Westchester? Well, the first thing is you have to determine is, what is success, really? What is it? Well, contrary to beliefs, success is not how many dollars you have in the bank or how many cars you drive. I know a bunch of millionaires and a couple of billionaires who are absolutely miserable. Believe me when I tell you that. The first rule of success is knowing exactly who you are and who you aren't, and being comfortable in your own skin. You know, I describe myself as a God-fearing heterosexual man who doesn't smoke, drink, get high, or do drugs. Most people who know me respect me just for being courageous enough to be unapologetically me. Whatever you are, whatever you do, it's cool. Just be that and be comfortable in that, and don't compromise who you are for anybody. Be nice to people. Karma is real. I wish I had a dollar just for every one person who did something horrible to me or stole my potato chips when I was in the 3rd grade, who eventually had to have their kid or themselves audition for me. And I don't forget. He stole my chips. No, it's not going to happen. Likewise, I can't begin to tell you of all the blessings I've had from just being nice to everyday people. Find out what your real passion in life is, and then find a way to make a career and a living out of doing that. Step up your marketing game, get your business cards, create your website on top of Facebook, on top of LinkedIn, on top of Twitter, and you have to get out and meet people, network, and sometimes even showcase your talents for free. Folks, please, take care of your health. Okay, we all know everybody here got away with a little something crazy while you were here at Westchester, a little something, okay? But now that you got that out of your system, get it together, watch what you eat, get your rest, and really take care of yourself, mentally, physically, and spiritually, because it's much harder to chase a dream from a hospital bed or a rehab center. Be on time, seriously. Lateness in the real world is viewed as disrespect to your boss and your fellow employees, and it will get you a bad reputation and fired quickly. Come on now, set the alarm, get there early. Expect that you will fail at something, but keep pushing forward. Donald Trump filed bankruptcy 4 times. Walt Disney filed bankruptcy 7 times. Michael Jordan was cut from this high school basketball team. Oprah was demoted because they said she wasn't fit for television. I've shared many of my feelings with you today, but we all grieved and we all regrouped, got motivated, and tried it again. Failure is just an opportunity to learn what not to do again. And every year I want you all to promise to do something that I call naked assessment. Now, what is naked assessment? Well, guys, it's not a rating system for actors in a certain type of film that some of you guys like to watch when you're feeling lonely. Actually, a naked assessment is an honest assessment of yourself, raw and real, just like you stepped out of the shower. Every year I take a vacation in January and I do my own assessment. I'm totally honest about what I like about myself, what I don't like about myself. I write down what I thought I did well, what I thought I didn't do so well. I make new goals for the year, and I make a list of people that I need to eliminate from my life. And yes, you will need to eliminate some people in your life to become successful. Most importantly, I firmly believe that you have to place your hopes, your dreams, your aspirations into the universe. When I was in the ninth grade, I had to write an essay on what I thought I would be doing when I was older. In the essay, I said, I would be a musician wearing a tuxedo, playing for the President of the United States, making $50,000 a year. That's what I said in ninth grade. Do you know I have a picture of myself in a tuxedo, playing for the President, making $50,000 that particular year? I said in an interview over 20 years ago that I would be an award-winning composer, writing and arranging music for motion pictures and television. Today I have 3 Emmy Awards for music for film and television, and I just finished contributing to my second major film with Academy Award-winning director Lee Daniels, which was this year's The Butler, starring Forest Whitaker and Oprah. Thank you. I said that one day I'd be playing acoustic piano behind a great singer on a Broadway stage, and I'm leaving here in a few minutes to accompany the greatest jazz singer on the planet right now, Miss Dee Dee Bridgewater and Lady Day on 42nd Street in New York. I wrote 4 years ago that I wanted to be able to travel the world at a moment's notice without having to worry about money. Oh, now let's see what happens with that one. Well, shortly after that, Hyatt Hotels came out with a promotional contest called the Big Welcome, where they were giving away 365 nights at any Hyatt around the world, 1 million airline miles, and a check for $50,000 to the one person in the world who would come up with the most creative idea about what they'd do if they won the prize. But they said you couldn't use any music. But I said, you know what? I'm going to call them up and ask them. I said, can I use music if it's my own music? And they said, yeah, you can. Ah. So what I decided to do was I went and I downloaded some pictures of bunch of Hyatt properties. I went to Toys R Us and I bought 4 musician puppets, like, you know, orange drummer, green guitar player, whatever. And I bought some toy planes. And then what I did was I put together a music video and I put on a black shirt and black gloves. And I had these puppets travel on these planes to go to all these Hyatts while singing this song, which was like a mixture of the Black Eyed Peas and the Beatles. So, long story short, I won this contest. Out of thousands and thousands of people, I won this contest. Was it luck? Maybe. But I asked for it, I did the work, and it happened. Since then, I've ziplined over canyons in the Caribbean, I've surfed in Maui, I've gazed at the view from the top of the world's tallest building in Dubai, I've mounted a camel and crossed over the Sahara to see the Great Pyramids in Egypt, I've ascended to the top of the wall of the Great Wall of China, swam with sharks without a cage in Sydney, Australia, been to the top of the Eiffel Tower in Paris, and stood at Nelson Mandela's cell in South Africa. Yes, you all can almost call me the Bronze Forrest Gump. Except I did not get shot in the buttocks. Most importantly, 31 years ago, after failing that last jazz band audition for the 4th straight time, I promised myself that I'd make enough out of my life and career that one day Westchester would ask me to come back here to deliver this commencement graduation speech that I'm delivering to you right now. I have to make this last point. Your family is everything. Quincy Jones, one of the greatest producers in the world, the guy who produced Michael Jackson's Thriller, Bad, and won 1 million awards in life, will tell you that his only regret was that he wasn't the best father. He was just too busy chasing his music career and his dreams to be there for his kids. Remember, you have to take time out for the people in your life who mean something to you. I decided to come off the road and leave my dreams of the bright lights in New York and film scores in Los Angeles to stay in Philly to be the father that I know my young daughter needed at the time. I wanted my daughter to know who her dad was and not just read about me on the internet. She's now in her first year of college, and amazingly, everything that I would have left her for to move to New York City or Los Angeles has now been given to me but only because of the connections and the reputation that I built because I stayed in Philly. And you know, that's just God working it out. For doing the right thing and sticking by your family. And that's what real success is. Many of your parents and loved ones who are here today are the real successes. Not because they're famous or won some big prize, but because they made a conscious decision to be there for you. They sacrificed for you. So you could have birthdays and Christmases. They borrowed, sold stuff, worked two or three jobs, and kept the house together, your siblings together, and you out of trouble. Some even mortgaged their own dreams so that you could have a chance to graduate from college to follow yours. I'd like to take a second to talk about a person. I'm sorry. I'd like to take a second to talk about a person who did all of that for me. He's my role model, my inspiration, my mentor, and my best friend. I couldn't have made it without him, his wisdom, and his support. He couldn't be here today, but he's listening and watching us right now from his hospital bed in Lincoln Hall Hospital. Please give a hand, if you will, for my dad, Elton Jolly. Thank you. My mother, Rowena, ironically passed 9 years ago to the day, today. I was there with her in the hospital when she took her last breath, and she was the best mother I could have ever dreamed of having. She's here with me in spirit, like right now. She said one thing to me a long time ago that always stuck with me, and I'd like to share it with you. One day I came to her because I was really upset about something that didn't go so well in my life. She asked me if I did the best that I could do. I said, yes, Mom, I did. She then said, well, why are you worried? You can't do any better than the best you can do. That simple statement made so much sense to me then, and it makes so much sense to me now. Why don't we all just give the best that we can at everything we choose to do, all the time? Doesn't it make sense? I mean, if we just choose to do that, we all can live a life filled with no regrets. In closing, I just want to say that success and blessings come to you in life when you are thankful and when you give back. And when you are humble for what you have been given. I am not here to preach to you today, but I can tell you right now that I would have never made it to where I am right now without God's presence in my life. So I ask you, class of 2013, do you have something to be grateful for? Anything? Is there someone here who encouraged you when you were ready to give up and quit? Is there a teacher who took that extra time and interest in you along the way when you just couldn't seem to figure it out? Is there someone here who may not be here physically, but whose spirit was the inspiration for you to make it to this point? Is there somebody in your life, it could be somebody who's here right now, who sacrificed their money, their time, and without waiver believed in you, your future, and your success so much that without them, you wouldn't be sitting where you are right now? If there is, I want you to stand up right now and show them how much you appreciate them. Come on. I'm asking you right now, class of 2013, what are you going to do in your life that's going to be big enough, bold enough, life-altering enough and inspirational enough to make you become the next Westchester University commencement speaker just like me? What are you going to do to continue to make your parents proud of you just like mine are right now? I want you to start preparing for success today. Create your own businesses, lead by example, or just simply do the right thing when it's called for. Don't just talk the talk, walk the walk. Take care of your families and the people who matter and infuse the world with great art, culture, wisdom, and commerce that not only will outlive your life, but will inspire the lives of children to come on this earth. Remember to take a minute to mentor those who dream of walking along your shadows and idolize your achievements. My hope today is that I could inspire just one person, maybe somebody who came from hard times, or somebody who may have been told that they're not good enough, smart enough, popular enough, or that one person that just needs a little encouragement and reassurance that it's going to be all right. I am you, and you are me. I continue to rise, even though the most difficult times I've been through, because I've decided that I am not just going to sit around and complain when I can gain so much more by staying calm and keeping a positive outlook on life. If it helps you, use me as an example of what can happen if you dare to dream. If I get hit by a bus tomorrow, don't show up at my funeral saying, "Oh, poor Bill." Come and tell somebody. That's how you do it. That's how you get it in. Tell them that I lived every day that God granted me on this earth trying to be the best man that I could be and trying to help somebody. Class of 2013, I want you to go after every single thing you want in life, no matter how big or small, and face the fears and disappointments that will surely come your way with the grace, courage, strength, and dignity of the true kings, queens, and warriors that are innately a part of your lineage and ancestral DNA. In closing, let me just say that my mother's passing on this day 9 years ago taught me one really important lesson, and that is life is very, very short. Tell the people that you love them and appreciate them now. And don't waste a lot of time with things, people, and circumstances that aren't healthy for you or going anywhere. Never give up on your dreams and never give up on your principles. Class of 2013, I want you to stay focused and I want you to stay encouraged. God will work all the rest of it out for you. Thank you so much and may God continue to bless you and your family.
Bill, I want to thank you very, very much for a commencement address that will be remembered for all of the right reasons.